This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Anglo-Prusso-Portuguese Coalition Victory Treaty of St. Petersburg 1762 Treaty of Hamburg 1762 Treaty of Paris 1763 Treaty of Hubertusburg 1763 Territorial changes status quo antebellum in Europe transfer of colonial possessions between Great Britain, France, Spain, and Portugal France cedes its possessions east of the Mississippi River, Canada accepts Saint-Pierre and Miquelon, the island of Grenada, and the northern Sarkars in India to Great Britain France cedes Louisiana west of the Mississippi River to Spain. Spain cedes Florida to Great Britain. Four neutral Caribbean islands divided between Britain. Saint Vincent, Tobago, Dominica and France. Saint Lucia belligerents. Commanders and leaders George II until 1760 George III from 1760 Duke of Devonshire until 1757 Duke of Newcastle from 1757 Marquess of Granby Robert Clive Geoffrey Amherst Frederick II Prince Henry Friedrich von Seydlitz King Joseph I Count William of Schomberg Lippe Duke Ferdinand King Louis XV Charles de Rohan Louis, Duke of Estrées Empress Maria Theresa Charles, Prince Lorraine Leopold, Count von Don Franz Moritz von Lacy Count Benyovsky Ernst, Baron von Laden Augustus III Count Rutowski Maximilian III Joseph Empress Elizabeth until 1762 Emperor Peter III from 1762 Count Pyotr Saltykov William Fermor Count Alexander Baturlin King Adolf Frederick Augustin Ehrensvard King Charles III Marquis of Sarria Count of Aranda Manuel Antonio Rojo Juan de Prado Pedro Antonio de Cevallos Alamgir II to 1759 Shah Alam II from 1759 Siraj Ud Dalla Nawab of the Carnatic VE Theatres of the Seven Years' War Silesia Pomerania Portugal North America West Indies West Africa India Anglo-Spanish Uruguay and Rio Grande do Sul VE Anglo-French Wars 1-2-1-3-1-4-1-2-1-5-1-7-1-2-4-2-4-3-1-2-9-4-1-3-0-3-1-3-3-7-1-4-5-3-1-4-9-6-9-8-1-5-1-2-1-4-1-5-2-2-6-1-5-4-2-4-6-1-5-5-7-5-9-1-6-2-7-1-6-8-9-9-7-1-7-0-2-1-3-1-7-4-4-8-1-7-5-4-6-3-1-7-7-8-8-3-1-7-9-3-1-8-0-2-1-8-0-3-1-4-1-8-1-5 The 7 Years' War was a war fought between 1754 and 1763, the main conflict occurring in the seven-year period from 1756 to 1763. It involved every European great power of the time except the Ottoman Empire, spanning five continents, and affected Europe, the Americas, West Africa, India, and the Philippines. The conflict split Europe into two coalitions, led by the Kingdom of Great Britain on one side and the Kingdom of France on the other for the first time, aiming to curtail Britain and Prussia's ever-growing might. France formed a grand coalition of its own, which ended with failure as Britain rose as the world's predominant power, altering the European balance of power contents 1 summary 2 nomenclature 3 background. 31 Europe 32 in North America 4 strategies 5 Europe 5-1-1756-52-1757-53-1758-54-1759-60-55-1761-62-56-1763-57 British amphibious descents 6 colonies 61 North America 62 South America 63 India 64 West Africa 7 outcome 8 cultural references 9 See also 10 Footnotes 11 Bibliography 111 Other Languages 112 Fiction 12 External Links Summary Conflict between Great Britain and France broke out in 1754-1756 when the British attacked disputed French positions in North America and seized hundreds of French merchant ships. Meanwhile, rising power Prussia was struggling with Austria for dominance within and outside the Holy Roman Empire in Central Europe in 1756. The major powers switched partners. Realizing that war was imminent, Prussia preemptively struck Saxony and quickly overran it. The result caused uproar across Europe because of Austria's alliance with France to recapture Silesia, which had been lost in a previous war. Prussia formed an alliance with Britain reluctantly. By following the Imperial Diet, most of the states of the Empire joined Austria's cause. The Anglo-Prussian alliance was joined by smaller German states, especially Hanover. Sweden, fearing Prussia's expansionist tendencies, went to war in 1757 to protect its Baltic dominions, seeing its chance when virtually all of Europe opposed Prussia. Spain, bound by the Pacte de Famille, intervened on behalf of France, and together they launched an utterly unsuccessful invasion of Portugal in 1762. The Russian Empire was originally aligned with Austria, fearing Prussia's ambition on the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, but switched sides upon the succession of Tsar Peter III in 1762. Many middle and small powers in Europe, unlike in the previous wars, tried to steer clear away from the escalating conflict, even though they had interests in the conflict or with the belligerents, like Denmark-Norway. Denmark-Norway was, however, close to being dragged into the war on France's side when Peter III became Russian emperor and switched sides. Dano-Norwegian and Russian armies were only seconds away from ending up in battle, but the Russian emperor was deposed before war formally broke out. The Dutch Republic, a longtime British ally, kept its neutrality intact, fearing the odds against Britain and Prussia fighting the great powers of Europe, and even tried to prevent Britain's domination in India. Naples, Sicily, and Savoy, although sided with the Franco-Spanish alliance, declined to join the coalition under fear of British power. The taxation needed for war caused the Russian people considerable hardship, being added to the taxation of salt and alcohol begun by Empress Elizabeth in 1759 to complete her addition to the Winter Palace. Like Sweden, Russia concluded a separate peace with Prussia. The war ended with the Treaty of Paris between France, Spain, and Great Britain, and the Treaty of Hubertusburg between Saxony, Austria, and Prussia. In 1763, the war was successful for Great Britain, which gained the bulk of New France in North America, Spanish Florida, some individual Caribbean islands in the West Indies, the colony of Senegal on the West African coast, and superiority over the French trading outposts on the Indian subcontinent. The Native American tribes were excluded from the settlement. A subsequent conflict, known as Pontiac's War, was also unsuccessful in returning them to their pre-war status in Europe. The war began disastrously for Prussia, but a combination of good luck and successful strategy saw King Frederick the Great manage to retrieve the Prussian position and retain the status quo ante bellum. Prussia emerged as a new European great power. Although Austria failed to retrieve the territory of Silesia from Prussia, its original goal, its military prowess, was also noted by the other powers. The involvement of Portugal, Spain, and Sweden did not return them to their former status as great powers. France was deprived of many of its colonies and had saddled itself with heavy war debts that its inefficient financial system could barely handle. Spain lost Florida but gained French Louisiana and regained control of its colonies, e.g., Cuba and the Philippines, which had been captured by the British during the war. France and Spain avenged their defeat in 1778 when the American Revolutionary War broke out, with hopes of destroying Britain's dominance once and for all. The Seven Years' War was perhaps the first true world war, having taken place almost 160 years before World War I and influenced many major events later around the globe. The war restructured not only the European political order, but also affected events all around the world, paving the way for the beginning of later British world supremacy in the 19th century, the rise of Prussia in Germany, the beginning of tensions in British North America, as well as a clear sign of France's eventual turmoil. It was characterized in Europe by sieges and the arson of towns, as well as open battles with heavy losses. Nomenclature in the historiography of some countries, the war is named after combatants in its respective theaters, e.g., the French and Indian War in the United States. In French-speaking Canada, it is known as the War of the Conquest, while it is called the Seven Years' War in English-speaking Canada. North America, 1754-1763, Pomeranian War with Sweden and Prussia, 1757-1762, Third Carnatic War on the Indian subcontinent, 1757-1763, and Third Silesian War with Prussia and Austria, 1756-1763. The conflict in India is termed the Third Carnatic War, while the fighting between Prussia and Austria is called the Third Silesian War in some of the English-speaking British colonies in North America, chiefly in the present-day United States. The conflict is known as the French and Indian War. Swedish historiography uses the name Pomerska Kriget, Pomeranian War, as Swedish involvement was limited to Pomerania in northern central Germany. The war has been described as the First World War, although this label was also given to various earlier conflicts like the 80 Years' War, the 30 Years' War, the War of the Spanish Succession and the War of the Austrian Succession, and to later conflicts like the Napoleonic Wars. The term Second Hundred Years' War has been used in order to describe the almost continuous level of worldwide conflict during the entire 18th century, reminiscent of the more famous and compact struggle of the 14th century. Background. Further information, Diplomatic Revolution Europe. This section needs additional citations for verification. Please help improve this article by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. May 2016. Learn how and when to remove this template message. All the participants of the Seven Years' War. Silesia from Austria. Empress Maria Theresa of Austria had signed the Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle in 1748 in order to gain time to rebuild her military forces and forge new alliances. The War of the Austrian Succession had seen the belligerents aligned on a time-honored basis. France's traditional enemies, Great Britain and Austria, had coalesced just as they had done against Louis XIV. Prussia, the leading anti-Austrian state in Germany, had been supported by France. Neither group, however, found much reason to be satisfied with its partnership. British subsidies to Austria produced nothing of much help to the British, while the British military effort had not saved Silesia for Austria. Prussia, having secured Silesia, came to terms with Austria in disregard of French interests. Even so, France concluded a defensive alliance with Prussia in 1747, and the maintenance of the Anglo-Austrian alignment after 1748 was deemed essential by the Duke of Newcastle, British Secretary of State in the ministry of his brother Henry Pelham. The collapse of that system and the alignment of France with Austria and of Great Britain with Prussia constituted what is known as the Diplomatic Revolution or the Reversal of Alliances. In 1756, Austria was making military preparations for war with Prussia and pursuing an alliance with Russia for this purpose. On 2 June 1746, Austria and Russia concluded a defensive alliance that covered their own territory and Poland against attack by Prussia or the Ottoman Empire. They also agreed to a secret clause that promised the restoration of Silesia and the Countship of Glatz, now Kłodzko, Poland to Austria in the event of hostilities with Prussia. Their real desire, however, was to destroy Frederick's power altogether, reducing his sway to his electorate of Brandenburg and giving East Prussia to Poland, an exchange that would be accompanied by the cession of the Polish Duchy of Courland to Russia. Alexei Petrovich, Graf Count Bestuzhev Ryaman, Grand Chancellor of Russia under Empress Elizabeth, was hostile to both France and Prussia, but he could not persuade Austrian statesman Wenzel Anton von Kaunitz to commit to offensive designs against Prussia so long as Prussia was able to rely on French support. Europe. In the years after the Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle in 1748, the Hanoverian King George II of Great Britain was passionately devoted to his family's continental holdings, but his commitments in Germany were counterbalanced by the demands of the British colonies overseas. If war against France for colonial expansion was to be resumed, then Hanover had to be secured against Franco-Prussian attack. France was very much interested in colonial expansion and was willing to exploit the vulnerability of Hanover in war against Great Britain, but it had no desire to divert forces to Central Europe for Prussia's interest. French policy was, moreover, complicated by the existence of the secret du roi, a system of private diplomacy conducted by King Louis XV. Unbeknownst to his foreign minister, Louis had established a network of agents throughout Europe with the goal of pursuing personal political objectives that were often at odds with France's publicly stated policies. Louis's goals for Le Secret du Roi included the Polish crown for his kinsman Louis François de Bourbon, Prince de Conti, and the maintenance of Poland, Sweden, and Turkey as French client states in opposition to Russian and Austrian interests. Frederick saw Saxony and Polish West Prussia as potential fields for expansion but could not expect French support if he started an aggressive war for them. If he joined the French against the British in the hope of annexing Hanover, he might fall victim to an Austro-Russian attack. The hereditary elector of Saxony, Augustus III, was also elective king of Poland as Augustus III, but the two territories were physically separated by Brandenburg and Silesia. Neither state could pose as a great power. Saxony was merely a buffer between Prussia and Austrian Bohemia, whereas Poland, despite its union with the ancient lands of Lithuania, was prey to pro-French and pro-Russian factions. A Prussian scheme for compensating Frederick Augustus with Bohemia in exchange for Saxony Saxony obviously presupposed further spoliation of Austria in the attempt to satisfy Austria at the time. Britain gave their electoral vote in Hanover for the candidacy of Maria Theresa's son, Joseph II, as the Holy Roman Emperor, much to the dismay of Frederick and Prussia. Not only that, Britain would soon join the Austro-Russian alliance, but complications arose. Britain's basic framework for the alliance itself was to protect Hanover's interests against France. At the same time, Kaunitz kept approaching the French in the hope of establishing just such an alliance with Austria. Not only that, France had no intention to ally with Russia, who, years earlier, had meddled in France's affairs during Austria's Succession War. France also saw the dismemberment of Prussia as threatening to the stability of Central Europe. Years later, Kaunitz kept trying to establish France's alliance with Austria. He tried as hard as he could to avoid Austrian entanglement in Hanover's political affairs, and was even willing to trade Austrian Netherlands for France's aid in recapturing Silesia. Frustrated by this decision and by the Dutch Republic's insistence on neutrality, Britain soon turned to Russia. On 30 September 1755, Britain pledged financial aid to Russia in order to station 50,000 troops on the Livonian-Lithuanian border, so they could defend Britain's interests in Hanover immediately. Bestuzhev, assuming the preparation was directed against Prussia, was more than happy to obey the request of the British unbeknownst to the other powers. King George II also made overtures to the Prussian king, Frederick, who, fearing the Austro-Russian intentions, was also desirous of a rapprochement with Britain. On 16 January 1756, the Convention of Westminster was signed, whereby Britain and Prussia promised to aid one another. The parties hoped to achieve lasting peace and stability in Europe. The carefully coded word in the agreement proved no less catalytic for the other European powers. The results were absolute chaos. Empress Elizabeth of Russia was outraged at the duplicity of Britain's position. Not only that, but France was enraged, and terrified, by the sudden betrayal of its only ally. Austria, particularly Kaunitz, used this situation to their utmost advantage. Now isolated, France was forced to accede to the Austro-Russian alliance or face ruin thereafter. On 1 May 1756, the First Treaty of Versailles was signed, in which both nations pledged 24,000 troops to defend each other in the case of an attack. This diplomatic revolution proved to be an important cause of the war. Although both treaties were self-defensive in nature, the actions of both coalitions made the war virtually inevitable. In North America, map of the British and French settlements in North America in 1750, before the French and Indian War 1754-1763, that was part of the Seven Years' War. The boundary between British and French possessions in North America was largely undefined. In the 1750s, France had long claimed the entire Mississippi River basin. This was disputed by Britain. In the early 1750s, the French began constructing a chain of forts in the Ohio River Valley to assert their claim and shield the Native American population from increasing British influence. The British settlers along the coast were upset that French troops would now be close to the western borders of their colonies. They felt the French would encourage their tribal allies among the North American natives to attack them also. The British settlers wanted access to the fertile land of the Ohio River Valley for the new settlers that were flooding into the British colonies seeking farm land. The most important French fort planned was intended to occupy a position at the Forks, where the Allegheny and Monongahela Rivers meet to form the Ohio River, present-day Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Peaceful British attempts to halt this fort construction were unsuccessful, and the French proceeded to build the fort they named Fort Duquesne. British colonial militia from Virginia were then sent to drive them out, led by George Washington. They ambushed a small French force at Jumonville Glen on 28 May 1754, killing 10, including Commander Jumonville. The French retaliated by attacking Washington's army at Fort Necessity on 3 July 1754 and forced Washington to surrender. News of this arrived in Europe, where Britain and France unsuccessfully attempted to negotiate a solution. The two nations eventually dispatched regular troops to North America to enforce their claims. The first British action was the assault on Acadia on 16 June 1755. In the Battle of Fort Beauséjour, which was immediately followed by their expulsion of the Acadians in July. British Major General Edward Braddock led about 2,000 army troops and provincial militia on an expedition to retake Fort Duquesne, but the expedition ended in disastrous defeat. In further action, Admiral Edward Boscawen fired on the French ship Alcide on 8 June 1755, capturing it and two troop ships in September 1755, French and British Troops met in the inconclusive Battle of Lake George. The British also harassed French shipping beginning in August 1755, seizing hundreds of ships and capturing thousands of merchant seamen. While the two nations were nominally at peace incensed, France prepared to attack Hanover, whose prince-elector was also the King of Great Britain and Minorca. Britain concluded a treaty whereby Prussia agreed to protect Hanover. In response, France concluded an alliance with its longtime enemy Austria, an event known as the Diplomatic Revolution. Strategies for much of the 18th century, France approached its wars in the same way it would let colonies defend themselves or would offer only minimal help, sending them limited numbers of troops or inexperienced soldiers, anticipating that fights for the colonies would most likely be lost anyway. This strategy was to a degree forced upon France. Geography, coupled with the superiority of the British Navy, made it difficult for the French Navy to provide significant supplies and support to French colonies. Similarly, several long land borders made an effective domestic army imperative for any French ruler. Given these military necessities, the French government, unsurprisingly, based its strategy overwhelmingly on the army in Europe. It would keep most of its army on the continent, hoping for victories closer to home. The plan was to fight to the end of hostilities and then, in treaty negotiations, to trade territorial acquisitions in Europe to regain lost overseas possessions, as had happened in, e.g., the Treaty of Saint-Germain and Ley 1632. This approach did not serve France well in the war, as the colonies were indeed lost, but although much of the European war went well, by its end France had few counterbalancing European successes. Liebgard Battalion at Kolin, 1757. The British, by inclination as well as for practical reasons, had tended to avoid large-scale commitments of troops on the continent. They sought to offset the disadvantage of this in Europe by allying themselves with one or more continental powers whose interests were antithetical to those of their enemies, particularly France. 15-16. By subsidizing the armies of continental allies, Britain could turn London's enormous financial power to military advantage in the Seven Years' War. The British chose as their principal partner the greatest general of the day, Frederick the Great of Prussia, then the rising power in Central Europe, and paid Frederick substantial subsidies for his campaigns. 106. This was accomplished in the Diplomatic Revolution of 1756, in which Britain ended its long-standing alliance with Austria in favour of Prussia, leaving Austria to side with France. In marked contrast to France, Britain strove to prosecute the war actively in the colonies, taking full advantage of its naval power. 64-66. The British pursued a dual strategy, naval blockade and bombardment of enemy ports, and rapid movement of troops by sea. They harassed enemy shipping and attacked enemy colonies, frequently using colonists from nearby British colonies in the effort. The Russians and the Austrians were determined to reduce the power of Prussia, the new threat on their doorstep along with France. They agreed in 1756 to mutual defense and an attack by Austria and Russia on Prussia, subsidized by France. Europe v. Seven Years' War, European Theater. Bohemia and Moravia. Pirna Lobositz Reichenberg. Prague. Siege of Prague. Kolin. Olomouc. Darmstadtel. Prussian Bohemia. Incursion. Westphalia and Hesse. Heisenbeck. Rheinberg. Krefeld. Bergen. Minden. Emsdorf. Warburg. Kloster. Kampen. Langensalza. First Castle. Grunberg. Korbach. Willinghausen. Olper. Wilhelmsthal. Nauheim. Second Castle. Saxony. First Lutterberg. Hochkirch. Hoyerswerda. Maxen. Meissen. Dresden. Torgau. Second Lutterberg. Rossbach. Freiburg. Brandenburg. Zorndorf. K. Künersdorf. Silesia. Landeshut. Glatz. Liegnitz. Berlin. Burkersdorf. Mois. Breslau. Leuthen. East Prussia. Gross. Jägersdorf. Pomeranian War. Stralsund. Torno. Fairbairn. Gusto. Frisches Hof. Pacewalk. Kohlberg. Neuensund. Neukölln. Fantastic War. Almeida. Valencia de Alcantara. Vila Vela de Rodau. Marvau. Naval Operations. Port Mayen. Minorca. Rochefort. Cartagena. Bay of Biscay. St. Malo. Cherbourg. St. Cast. Britain. Quiberon Bay. Belle Ile. Cadiz. Cape Finisterre. VE. Seven Years' War, Invasion Campaign. 1759. Le Havre. Lagos. Quiberon Bay. Carrickfergus. Bishop's Court. VE. Seven Years' War, Fantastic War. Portugal. Almeida. Valencia de Alcantara. Vila Vela de Rodau. Marvau. Uruguay. VE. Anglo-Spanish War. 1762-1763. Europe. 31 May 1762. Spain. 2 October 1762. VE. Seven Years' War, British Amphibious Descents. 1757-61. Rochefort Street, Malo. Cherbourg. St. Cast. Belle Ile. William Pitt the Elder, who entered the cabinet in 1756, had a grand vision for the war that made it entirely different from previous wars. With France as Prime Minister, Pitt committed Britain to a grand strategy of seizing the entire French Empire, especially its possessions in North America and India. Britain's main weapon was the Royal Navy, which could control the seas and bring as many invasion troops as were needed. He also planned to use colonial forces from the 13 American colonies, working under the command of British regulars, to invade New France in order to tie the French army down. He subsidized his European allies. Pitt was head of the government from 1756 to 1761, and even after that the British continued his strategy. It proved completely successful. Pitt had a clear appreciation of the enormous value of imperial possessions, and realized the vulnerability of the French Empire. 1756 Wikisource has original text related to this article. Admiral John Byng's account of the Battle of Minorca 1756. The British Prime Minister, the Duke of Newcastle, was optimistic that the new series of alliances could prevent war from breaking out in Europe. However, a large French force was assembled at Toulon, and the French opened the campaign against the British by an attack on Minorca in the Mediterranean. A British attempt at relief was foiled at the Battle of Minorca, and the island was captured on 28 June, for which Admiral Byng was court-martialed and executed. Britain declared formally war to France with a declaration signed on 17 May, nearly 2 years after fighting had broken out in the Ohio Country. Battle of Lobositz. Austria, Blue, Prussia, Red. Frederick, using the Saxon army and treasury to aid the Prussian war effort. His second goal was to advance into Bohemia, where he might set up winter quarters at Austria's expense. Thirdly, he wanted to invade Moravia from Silesia, seize the fortress at Olmütz, and advance on Vienna to force an end to the war accordingly, leaving Field Marshal Count Kurt von Schwerin in Silesia with 25,000 soldiers to guard against incursions from Moravia and Hungary, and leaving Field Marshal Hans von Lewalt in East Prussia to guard against Russian invasion from the east. Frederick set off with his army for Saxony. The Prussian army marched in three columns. On the right was a column of about 15,000 men under the command of Prince Ferdinand of Brunswick. On the left was a column of 18,000 men under the command of the Duke of Brunswick. Bavern. In the center was Frederick II, himself with Field Marshal James Keith commanding a corps of 30,000 troops. Ferdinand of Brunswick was to close in on the town of Chemnitz. The Duke of Brunswick Bavern was to traverse Lusatia to close in on Bautzen. Meanwhile, Frederick and Keith would make for Dresden. The Saxon and Austrian armies were unprepared, and their forces were scattered. Frederick occupied Dresden with little or no opposition from the Saxons at the Battle of Lobositz on 1 October 1756. Frederick prevented the isolated Saxon army from being reinforced by an Austrian army under General Brown. The Prussians then occupied Saxony. After the Siege of Pirna, the Saxon army surrendered in October 1756, and was forcibly incorporated into the Prussian army. The attack on neutral Saxony caused outrage across Europe and led to the strengthening of the anti-Prussian coalition. The only significant Austrian success was the partial occupation of Silesia. Far from being easy, Frederick's early successes proved indecisive and very costly for Prussia's smaller army. This led him to remark that he did not fight the same Austrians as he had during the previous war. Britain had been surprised by the sudden Prussian offensive but now began shipping supplies and 670,000 liras, equivalent to 899 million liras in 2015, to its new ally. A combined force of Allied German states was organized by the British to protect Hanover from French invasion. Under the command of the Duke of Cumberland, the British attempted to persuade the Dutch Republic to join the alliance, but the request was rejected, as the Dutch wished to remain fully neutral despite the huge disparity in numbers. The year had been successful for the Prussian-led forces on the continent, in contrast to the British campaigns in North America. 1757 Battle of Poland. See also, Pomeranian War on 18 April 1757, Frederick II again took the initiative by marching into the Kingdom of Bohemia, hoping to inflict a decisive defeat on Austrian forces after winning the bloody Battle of Prague on 6 May 1757, in which both forces suffered major casualties. The Prussians forced the Austrians back into the fortifications of Prague. The Prussian army then laid siege to the city in response. Don collected a force of 30,000 men to come to the relief of Prague following the battle at Prague. Frederick took 5,000 troops from the siege at Prague and sent them to reinforce the 19,000-man army under the Duke of Brunswick. Bavern at Kolin in Bohemia. Austrian Marshal Don arrived too late to participate in the Battle of Prague, but picked up 16,000 men who had escaped from the battle. With this army he slowly moved to relieve Prague, the Prussian army was too weak to simultaneously besiege Prague and keep Don away, and Frederick was forced to attack prepared positions. The resulting Battle of Kolin was a sharp defeat for Frederick. His losses further forced him to lift the siege and withdraw from Bohemia altogether. Battle of Rossbach. Later that summer, the Russians under Field Marshal Stepan Fyodorovich Apraksin besieged Memel with 75,000 troops. Memel had one of the strongest fortresses in Prussia. However, after 5 days of artillery bombardment, the Russian army was able to storm it. The Russians then used Memel as a base to invade East Prussia and defeated a smaller Prussian force in the fiercely contested Battle of Gross Jägersdorf on 30 August 1757. In the words of the American historian Daniel Marston, Gross Jägersdorf left the Prussians with a newfound respect for the fighting capabilities of the Russians that was reinforced in the later battles of Zorndorf and Kunersdorf. However, the Russians were not yet able to take Königsberg after using up their supplies of cannonballs at Memel and Gross Jägersdorf and retreated soon afterward. A recurring problem for the Russians throughout the war was their logistics. The Russians lacked a quartermaster's department capable of keeping armies operating in Central Europe properly supplied over the primitive mud roads of Eastern Europe. The tendency of Russian armies to break off operations after fighting a major battle, even when they were not defeated, was less about their casualties and more about their supply lines. After expending much of their munitions in a battle, Russian generals did not wish to risk another battle knowing resupply would be a long time coming. This long-standing weakness was evident in the Russian-Ottoman War of 1735-1739, where Russian battle victories led to only modest war gains due to problems supplying their armies. The Russian quartermaster's department had not improved, so the same problems reoccurred in Prussia still. The Imperial Russian army was a new threat to Prussia. Not only was Frederick forced to break off his invasion of Bohemia, he was now forced to withdraw further into Prussian-controlled territory. His defeats on the battlefield brought still more opportunistic nations into the war. Sweden declared war on Prussia and invaded Pomerania with 17,000 men. Sweden felt this small army was all that was needed to occupy Pomerania and felt the Swedish army would not need to engage with the Prussians because the Prussians were occupied on so many other fronts. Battle of Leuthen by Karl Rochling. Frederick and staff at Leuthen. Things were looking grim for Prussia now, with the Austrians mobilizing to attack Prussian-controlled soil and a combined French and Reichsarmee German States Army under Prince Soubise approaching from the west. The Reichsarmee was a collection of armies from the smaller German states that banded together to heed the appeal of the Holy Roman Emperor Franz I against Frederick. However, in November and December 1757, the whole situation in Germany was reversed. First, Frederick devastated Soubise's forces at the Battle of Rossbach on 5 November 1757 and then routed a vastly superior Austrian force at the Battle of Leuthen on 5 December 1757. Rossbach was the only battle between the French and the Prussians during the entire war. At Rossbach, the Prussians lost about 548 men killed, while the Franco-German force under Soubise lost about 10,000 killed. Frederick always called Leuthen his greatest victory, an assessment shared by many at the time, as the Austrian army was considered to be a highly professional force. With these victories, Frederick once again established himself as Europe's premier general and his men as Europe's most accomplished soldiers. In spite of this, the Prussians were now facing the prospect of four major powers attacking on four fronts: France from the west, Austria from the south, Russia from the east, and Sweden from the north. Meanwhile, a combined force from a number of smaller German states such as Bavaria had been established under Austrian leadership, thus threatening Prussian control of Saxony. This problem was compounded when the main Hanoverian army under Cumberland was defeated at the Battle of Heisenbeck and forced to surrender entirely at the Convention of Klosterseven following a French invasion of Hanover. The convention removed Hanover and Brunswick from the war, leaving the western approach to Prussian territory extremely vulnerable. Frederick sent urgent requests to Britain for more substantial assistance, as he was now without any outside military support for his forces in Germany. Battle of Quiberon Bay. Calculating that no further Russian advance was likely until 1758, Frederick moved the bulk of his eastern forces to Pomerania under the command of Marshal Leywald, where they were to repel the Swedish invasion in short order. The Prussian army drove the Swedes back, occupied most of Swedish Pomerania, and blockaded its capital Stralsund. George Men agreed to a political partnership and formed a coalition government that gave new, firmer direction to the war effort. The new strategy emphasized both Newcastle's commitment to British involvement on the continent, particularly in defense of Germany, and Pitt's determination to use naval power to seize French colonies around the globe. This dual strategy would dominate British policy for the next 5 years. Between 10 and 17 October 1757, a Hungarian general, Count András Hadik, serving in the Austrian army, executed what may be the most famous Hussar action in history when the Prussian king, Frederick, was marching south with his powerful armies. The Hungarian general unexpectedly swung his force of 5,000, mostly Hussars, around the Prussians and occupied part of their capital, Berlin. For one night the city was spared for a negotiated ransom of $200,000. When Frederick heard about this humiliating occupation, he immediately sent a larger force to free the city. Hadik, however, left the city with his Hussars and safely reached the Austrian line subsequently. Hadik was promoted to the rank of marshal in the Austrian army 1758. In early 1758, Frederick launched an invasion of Moravia, and laid siege to Olmütz, now Olomouc, Czech Republic, following an Austrian victory at the Battle of Domstadtel that wiped out a supply convoy destined for Olmütz. Frederick broke off the siege and withdrew from Moravia. It marked the end of his final attempt to launch a major invasion of Austrian territory. In January 1758, the Russians invaded East Prussia, where the province, almost denuded of troops, put little opposition. East Prussia had been occupied by Russian forces over the winter and would remain under their control until 1762. Although Frederick did not see the Russians as an immediate threat and instead entertained hopes of first fighting a decisive battle against Austria that would knock them out of the war. Battle of Krefeld, a map of the area in the Gentleman's Magazine in April 1758, the British concluded the Anglo-Prussian Convention with Frederick, in which they committed to pay him an annual subsidy of £670,000. Britain also dispatched 9,000 troops to reinforce Ferdinand's Hanoverian army, the first British troop commitment on the continent, and a reversal in the policy of Pitt. Ferdinand had succeeded in driving the French from Hanover and Westphalia and re-captured the port of Emden in March 1758 before crossing the Rhine with his own forces, which caused alarm in France. Despite Ferdinand's victory over the French at the Battle of Krefeld and the brief occupation of Dusseldorf, he was compelled by the successful maneuvering of larger French forces to withdraw across the Rhine. By this point, Frederick was increasingly concerned by the Russian advance from the east and marched to counter it just east of the Oder in Brandenburg-Neumark. At the Battle of Zorndorf, now Sarbinowo, Poland, a Prussian army of 35,000 men under Frederick on 25 August 1758, fought a Russian army of 43,000 commanded by Count William Fermor. Both sides suffered heavy casualties, the Prussians 12,800, the Russians 18,000, but the Russians withdrew, and Frederick claimed victory. The American historian Daniel Marston described Zorndorf as a draw, as both sides were too exhausted and had taken such losses that neither wished to fight another battle with the other. In the undecided Battle of Torno on 25 September, a Swedish army repulsed 6 assaults by a Prussian army but did not push on Berlin. Following the Battle of Fairbairn, Battle of Hochkirch, the war was continuing indecisively when on 14 October Marshal Don's Austrians surprised the main Prussian army at the Battle of Hochkirch in Saxony. Frederick lost much of his artillery but retreated in good order. Helped by dense woods, the Austrians had ultimately made little progress in the campaign in Saxony despite Hochkirch and had failed to achieve a decisive breakthrough after a thwarted attempt to take Dresden. Don's troops were forced to withdraw to Austrian territory for the winter, so that Saxony remained under Prussian occupation. At the same time, the Russians failed in an attempt to take Kolberg in Pomerania, now Kolobrzeg, Poland, from the Prussians in France. 1758 had been disappointing, and in the wake of this, a new chief minister, the Duc de Choiseul, was appointed. Choiseul planned to end the war in 1759 by making strong attacks